The norm is a topological structure that gives us the concept of length or size of one element in the set. The definition says that a real-valued function is a norm on the set capital X if and only if, for all elements x and y in the set, the following conditions are satisfied. And when going through these conditions, I will use the term length for the function to add some intuition to the conditions. I could also have called it the size or the magnitude of the element. First, the length of an element must always be larger than or equal to zero. And we can jump directly to the fourth condition. The length of an element being zero is equivalent to this being the zero element in the set. This means that if the length of an element is zero, then this must be the zero element. No other elements have zero length, and together with the first condition, it means that the length of all elements other than the zero element have to be strictly positive. The second condition states that the length function has to satisfy the triangle inequality, meaning that the length of the sum of two elements cannot be larger than the sum of the length of each of the elements. Think, for instance, of the length of a two-dimensional vector, which we can draw as an arrow in a two-dimensional coordinate frame, like this, and which is the sum of these two vectors, x and y. Then the triangle inequality says that the length of this vector has to be smaller than or equal to the length of the vector x plus the length of the vector y. And finally, the length function must satisfy the homogeneity condition, meaning that if we multiply an element by any scalar number alpha, then the length of the result is the length of the original element scaled by the absolute value of alpha. Say, for instance, that alpha is 2, and that the element x is multiplied by this. Then the length, meaning the norm, of the element 2 times x is 2 times as long as the length of the original element x. So the norm gives us a way to measure the length of an element, and this is a stronger concept than the metric in the sense that if a set has a norm, then this norm also gives the set a metric. We say that it induces a metric, and this induced metric between two elements x and y is given by the norm of x minus y. In other words, if we can measure the length of an element in the set, then we can use this to also measure the distance between two elements in the set, giving this induced metric. For the set of all n-dimensional vectors with real-valued components, we have several alternative ways to measure the length of the vectors. These are called the 1 norm, the 2 norm, etc., up to the infinity norm. And in general, the p norm for any value of p from 1 up to infinity is found by taking the absolute value of each of the elements xi and raise it to the power p. Then we sum all these and we take the pth root of this sum. To illustrate this, we can use the set of two-dimensional vectors with real-valued components. The vector x has two components, x1 and x2. The absolute value of x1 is the length of this line segment here, and the absolute value of x2 is the length of this line segment here. The 1 norm of x is the absolute value of x1 plus the absolute value of x2. So it is the length of this line segment here plus the length of this line segment here. This norm, the 1 norm, induces the taxicab metric. That is the one metric that we defined when discussing metrics. To find the two norm, we take the absolute value of x1 squared plus the absolute value of x2 squared, and then we take the square root of this sum. By Pythagoras, we know that this is the length of the straight line from the origin to x. This is the Euclidean norm, and the metric induced by this norm is the Euclidean metric, the 2 metric. As for the infinity metric, the same argument as we have made earlier also holds here. When p goes to infinity, the largest element that is raised to the power p will dominate all the others in the sum, and we are therefore left with this element raised to the power p, and then we take the pth root of this, and we are left with the element itself. So in the two-dimensional case, the infinity norm of x is the largest of the absolute value of x1 and the absolute value of x2. And in this particular example, it is the length of this line segment here. This is the longest line segment representing the largest absolute value, and the infinity norm induces the infinity metric. The set of all n-dimensional vectors thus have several different norms defined on it, and the set together with any of these norms thus constitute a Banach space. Often we choose to use the Euclidean metric and the Euclidean norm, but sometimes it is easier to solve a problem and, for instance, prove a stability result using another norm. And then there is a nice feature to notice about the p-norms, and that is that all these norms are equivalent. That means that for any two values of p, let's call these alpha and beta, there exist two positive real constants, c1 and c2, such that this inequality here is satisfied. In other words, the beta norm is lower and upper bounded by the alpha norm. For instance, take the 2 norm and the infinity norm. Then exists two constants, c1 and c2, such that the infinity norm is lower bounded by c1 times the 2 norm of x, and upper bounded by c2 times the 2 norm of x. This means that if we're able to show that the property holds for one of the norms, it will also hold for the other norm. Say for instance that in one case we find it easier to solve a problem and prove something using the infinity norm, but we would rather have the result yielding the 2 norm. We can then choose to use the norm that is easiest for us, and then use this equivalence to show that it also holds for the other p-norm. Let us look at the set of all real-valued continuous functions defined on the set from A to B. Also here we have several alternative ways of measuring the length of an element, that is, the magnitude of the function, and we call these the LP norms, and they are defined for any p from 1 up to infinity. We find the general p-norm by taking the integral of the absolute value of the function raised to the power p. We take the integral from a to b, and then we take the pth root of the result. In the extreme case, when p goes to infinity, the largest absolute value of f as time varies between a and b will dominate the Riemannian sum that we make when we integrate, and the L-infinity norm is thus the supremum of the absolute value in the interval from a to b. You may not have seen the term supremum before, so I will define this. The supremum of a set S is the least upper bound of the set. We can illustrate this through an example. Say that we have the set S1 consisting of all numbers from 0 to 1, including both 0 and 1, and let S2 be the set of all numbers from 0 to 1, but not including 0 and 1. Let's start with S1. To find the supremum of S1, we need to find an upper bound of the set, that is, a number that is larger than or equal to any number in the set S1. This upper bound could, for instance, be 10 or 100, but to find the supremum, we need to find the least upper bound, the smallest value that still is larger than or equal to all the elements in the set. We easily see that this is 1, so the supremum of S1 equals 1. We can do the same for S2, and we find that the supremum of S2 is also equal to 1. How does this relate to the maximum of S1 and S2? The maximum of a set is the largest value of the set, and this is important. This means that the maximum of a set S has to be an element in the set. For the set S1, the maximum is 1. So the maximum of S1 equals 1. But what is the maximum of S2? We're actually not able to find any element in this set that is larger than all the other elements, no matter which value we choose. Let's, for instance, choose 0.9999 as our candidate. We can always find a larger one by adding a digit, for instance, 1. at the end here. So there does not exist a maximum for the set S2. And this is why we use the supremum in the definition of the L-infinity norm. When the maximum exists, then the maximum and the supremum are the same, but the maximum does not necessarily exist for all sets, so we use the supremum for generality. The set of all real-valued continuous functions defined on the set from A to B thus has several norms defined on it, and the set together with any of these LP norms is a Banach space. The special case when the functions are defined on the set from 0 to infinity, which is typically the case when we consider time-varying functions, are given a special name. This set, together with any of the LP norms, is called the LP space. When we are given a real-valued continuous function, say for instance a function of time t, which is defined for all time from 0 to infinity, so f maps the set from time being 0 up to infinity to some real number, then this function is clearly an element in this set. But it is not necessarily an element of the LP space. We define that the function f is an element in the LP space if and only if the function's LP norm is bounded. In other words, there must exist a positive constant c such that the LP norm of the function is smaller than or equal to this constant.